departure from what's been funded in the past, and the reason I got involved in this is some work that I had been doing in Micronesia before coming here. I'd certainly like to acknowledge Jerry Davis from NOAA's PIRO office, the Pacific Island Regional Office, and also the people at Malama Mauna Lua. I guess Alyssa was here earlier and had to depart, and also the Nature Conservancy, Eric Ho, and some of the people we've been working with together. Prior to coming to Hawaii, a lot of my work was focused in on islands in Micronesia, and we had a project, actually Mike Hamnett, myself, Jerry Davis, and a modeler, a physical oceanographer, Eric Wolanski. And what we'd been really investigating was the linkages between land and sea, which is a no-brainer for Hawaii, the Ahuwhaa system. You can see after any rainstorm a couple weeks ago, after the big winds and rains, you could just see everything from the land encroaching on the ocean. But in the work that I have done in the past on reproductive biology of corals, coral reefs persist on the basis of two processes: reproduction, the formation of new individuals from prior stock, and recruitment, the ability of this new stock to be able to then settle, metamorphose, and become part of the reef. And when we look at basically six chemically mediated steps from a spawning event, we do have a number of spawning corals in Hawaii. We also have brooding corals. Everything from the synchronization to the egg-sperm interactions, to fertilization development to the planula larva, to the interactions with crustose coral and algae, so it's an appropriate thing. Many of the corals that we work with will only be induced to metamorphose in response to chemicals either associated with bacteria or the crustose corallins. In this case, it's an Acropora with Hydrolithon rumboldii, and then eventually the acquisition of Zooxanthellae. But anything that you do that interferes with either water quality or substratum quality begins that downhill slide. These first four links are very susceptible to water-soluble compounds. The last two are particularly affected by lipophilic, that is, fat-soluble compounds. But what you can see here is that you can do a traditional bioassay with, say, fertilization. But if you get zero recruitment, it's the same thing as if you had 100% mortality up here. So a lot of the assays that have been used traditionally, LD50s, LC50s, looking at these concentrations doesn't take into account the integration of water and substratum quality. And, you know, this is Guam, but this is also Mauna Loa, this is also Kaneohe Bay. Basically, the big issue in Hawaii was flood control. So the Army Corps of Engineers, since they began their efforts here, has all been about getting the water off the land and into the ocean as a convenient dumping ground. What they haven't investigated then is what happens when these plumes get out into the ocean. This is one of our small watersheds in Guam. And you can look at concentric circles of complete coral mortality here, a few species, Porites, barely hanging on. And as you work your way out from the source areas, you can see varying levels of impacts. Once again, it's a water quality and substratum quality issue. This goes very well with some of the things that Ivar said and others, that in places, and we've noticed it certainly since I got here in Hawaii, there's a real disconnect between the fishing community, the environmental community, the scientific community, and the management community. And I think that's an understatement. And the problem is the fishermen, and rightfully so, will say, why are you picking on me when this huge plume is coming right out and you're not doing anything about that? And in some ways, they're justified. But again, it's all of these synergisms working together. Interestingly enough, it's the community in Mauna Loa that came together to say the stakeholders, the fishing community, the business community, the landowners, and the businesses all came to the same conclusion. The bay sucks. There's a lot of problems there with algae, with pollution, with sedimentation. And when you start with a community that's motivated and has a consensus that there's a problem, that's where we started the involvement. And they came to us to say, can you provide us with science to support the management initiatives we'd like to move forward on? You know, this is something you'll find all around Hawaii. You'll find all around Micronesia. And what this shows clearly is a reef that's dead and buried, a few Porites hanging on in there, but no self-respecting coral larva could ever settle and metamorphose on the loose sediment. So what we have is a system that's dead and continuing to die and will never, ever, ever recover under these circumstances. And again, the synergism between Jen Smith's work, the work that Celia Smith has been doing, the same way that plants on land will stabilize sediment and soil, they do the same thing in the ocean. So add some invasive species, add some algal turf, and what you have is a situation that continues to remain. It's a chronic system that will not clean up. And what we find is that the synergism between the algae and the sediment is such that you don't even need another rainstorm to get total blackout in the water column. Every time you get a wave event, every time you get any kind of wind, the sediment gets resuspended, and along with that are a lot of toxicants as well. We know that sediment is a very good carrier of toxicants from land into the ocean, so we see a number of effects going on. When we take a look at some of the activities, this is, again, Guam. Here's the Mangilao Golf Course here. Here's the reef over here. And we've been able to measure not only the physical effects of sediment, but the pesticides carried by sediment too. On the x-axis here, we've got treatments of chlorpyrifos, which is the most commonly used pesticide out there. Here's coral larval recruitment. And at 0.5 parts per billion, 5 and 50 parts per billion, we get a statistically significant inhibition of larval recruitment. And without any larvae recruiting, annual mortality is going to occur for natural and human-induced reasons, but you've got a system that's simply unsustainable.